BT dan juga undang-undang persekutuan.
Ya, itu sudah tentu mempunyai satu sebab untuk diteliti.
Yeah.
Dan kita ada lagi seorang pemanggil ya di talian, Cik Kamarul Bahrain dari Kelana Jaya. Hello.
Hello.
Yes. Cik Kamarul.
Selamat malam.
Selamat malam.
Selamat malam kepada Datuk V.
Yes, selamat malam.
Okay. Saya ada satu soalan.
Silakan.
Satu kebimbangan. Ibu Boman, boleh saya berbahasa Inggeris?
Sure, Cameron.
Okay, Batuk. I'm concerned over the proliferation of so many massage and reflexology outlets in my neighborhood and other places practically all over the country.
Okay.
Since that so many of these places offer other types of services as well alongside the normal massage. And I feel that these the local councils that issue the licenses somehow do not really pay attention on what are the true intentions of these business operators. And what is the law on this when they issue the licenses? It's like there's no due diligence in when they are issuing these licenses. And I feel that the laws that are already there are not strong enough to filter out such businesses before they operate, highlighting the arrests of girls, prostitutes, if you may call them, on TV and newspapers are actually too late. It should be nipped in the bud. So that's my question, or rather my concern over this matter. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Cik Kamarul, for your concern. Kamarul Bahrain from Kelana Jaya. With regards to massage and reflexology services, iaitu perkhidmatan urut dan juga reflexology yang lesen yang dikeluarkan oleh PBT, license issued by local councils, and there's no due diligence when the license is being issued. Perhaps there is an absence of the law to filter illegal or immoral activities. Yeah, with regards to the issuance of this license. Your comment. That's it.
Thank you so much, Kamarul. First thing first, when the local authority issue a license for outlet to conduct business such as massage and reflexology, the license is very clear. You must do it in such a manner that you will not breach the law, such as if you have conducted any other activities such as prostitution and all that, then you have breached the law, and then action can be taken. But how action can be taken normally relies on two instances. The first one is that there must be information given to the relevant authority by complainant. Normally this will come in the forms of people who knows what is happening in that. Secondly, of course, action can be taken when the local authority make a raid in all these places upon maybe receiving information.
So the raid is conducted.
So there are two instances here, but we must not forget the facts that a healthy massage parlor and reflexology centers, we provide services to people who need this kind of services. But anything more than that, we rely on information to be given by the general public. Because in most instances, local authority will be faced with a shortage of manpower to conduct raids and all these observations. Because you cannot simply just go into a center and then go in there and then disturb the business when nothing illegal is going on. But
Public cooperation is very
public
much
cooperation is very very important.
Okay, we have another caller on the line. Pemanggil di talian, Tuan Haji Dahlan, one of our regulars actually. Hello.
Hello, selamat malam, Em.
Selamat malam, Tuan Haji.
Selamat malam, Datuk. Ini I'm expanding my views regarding about bank instrument like credit card, debit card and cash card. Boleh tak kalau misalnya kita kontrolkan credit card atau exposekan credit card for internal use? Only for credit card. Dan only kita encourage people using debit card and cash card saja. sebab ini dapat merujukkan apa bilangan-bilangan yang bankrupt dan yang first ni. Boleh tak? Jadi ada detrimental pada our retail economy kalau misalnya kita kontrolkan credit card to 3,000 limit ya. Even really respective of how much your income is, it doesn't matter. But only 3,000 kalau kita bagi apa ni, MOF bagi 3,000 ya credit limit. So and then outside you can spend more. But outside, is there a way?
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, yeah, Tuan Haji Dahlan. This is on credit card, 3,000 hat during this time.
So say it's the usage of credit card is up to the person. Where prudent is very important. Menjaga-jaga menggunakan credit card.
That's quite a good suggestion as well. If you have a limit of 3,000, then you tend to pay when you use. You use a credit card first. Perhaps you don't have cash at that time, and then immediately mungkin selepas satu atau dua hari pergi ke bank dan membayar. Ya,
that would be a good habit for a credit card holder to pay on time. So if you pay on time, let's say if you have used up 1,000 ringgit, and before the month end you pay that 1,000 ringgit, you may not be charged interest for that.
Yes.
Yeah. And so, but in most cases, people will tend to use more, and then it will accumulate toward by the end of next month or the month after that, and that will be the problem. This is where prudence is very, very important to use a credit card,
which most people perhaps don't have,
because you cannot deny the fact that credit card can be useful also in instances, because first thing first, you don't carry cash. When you travel to other places,
especially if you have to pay for large amounts,
that's right. So you don't carry cash, and it'll be helpful for you to pay certain amounts of money. Then, of course, this is where prudence come in, where you need to actually pay in time. Once you pay in time, then you may not incur all this unnecessary interest and charges. And that, of course, I think the idea is good. Maybe we will look into it and to make sure that you know, we can actually limit, not to say limit, but we have to look into ways and how to accommodate people who may be able to
be prudent,
and then also who can afford to use credit cards.
Because it's unfair for those who are prudent, but given only a 3,000 ringgit limit.
We are using so many plastic money at the moment. These are all plastic.
Plastic is a good one. Okay, we gonna take a short break. Berehat sebentar dan kita akan kembali berbincang dan juga melihat juga beberapa lagi aspek dari segi pembaharuan undang-undang Malaysia. Bersama kami di studio Datuk Liew Vui Kiong, iaitu Timbalan Menteri di Jabatan Perdana Menteri yang kini mempunyai jawatankuasa untuk meneliti undang-undang Malaysia yang perlu diperbaharui. Kembali sebentar lagi. Ya, undang-undang pembaharuan Malaysia yang kini sebenarnya diteliti dan juga dipantau oleh jawatankuasa pembaharuan undang-undang Malaysia yang diterajui oleh Datuk Liew Vui Kiong, Timbalan Menteri di Jabatan Perdana Menteri, juga ahli parlimen sandakan bersama kami di studio, yang sebenarnya telah aktif ya tadi menjawab pelbagai soalan ya. YB, mungkin ada kebimbangan juga ya dari segi undang-undang yang berkaitan offences atau kesalahan seperti saman ekor, yang melapikkan saman ekor, atau undang-undang rogol, dan juga undang-undang yang boleh mengawal ya kes atau isu pembuangan bayi. Mungkin kita boleh berbincang ya secara ringkas kerana kita ada masa lebih kurang dari 10 minit.